As for today's program, we are delighted to host Dr. Hilary Kaiser for Mademoiselle and the American Soldier, French War Brides of World War I. Hilary was born in New York City, but grew up in San Francisco. She has been living in Paris, France for 50 years and is a dual American and French national. She has a BA in French from San Francisco State University and a master's and PhD in Anglophone studies from the University of Paris. Now retired, she first taught English and American civilization at a French lycée or high school, and then international communication as a tenured professor at the University of Paris. She has also worked as a cross-cultural trainer for corporate employees who are being relocated abroad. A history buff with a keen interest in collecting first-person accounts of people's experiences during wartime, she conducted two independent oral projects, one of American World War II veterans living in France, and the other of French war brides of American soldiers of World War I and World War II. She used her interviews to write two books, which were published in both French and English, and we will post links to those books in the chat. For her War Brides Oral History project, Hilary interviewed 27 women, 15 of whom appear in her book, French War Brides in America, later renamed French War Brides, Mademoiselle and the American Soldier. Most of the interviews were conducted in different parts of the US, and all but four were originally in French. Because of her own personal background, her research, and her work as an academic and corporate trainer, Hilary is greatly interested in cultural differences and misunderstandings, especially those related to Americans and the French. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Kaiser for today's incredible conversation.
Thank you, Haley, for that nice introduction and for all the help you've given me to prepare today's presentation. And thanks to Laura, who's one of the people in the background, who for all the technical help. And many, many thanks to the National World War I Museum and Memorial, because I found some beautiful photos that you'll see during my PowerPoint presentation. And I'm very happy that all of you are attending today. All right, some people have asked me how I got interested in the subject of war brides. Well, the idea came after I completed my first book, which was based on interviews I did in 1993 with World War II American veterans living in France. And you have some of their pictures here today. And as you can see, one of my interviewees was the commander of the local post in Paris of the American Legion. And the another one was the commander of the Veterans of Foreign Wars post in Paris. And I had a very, very interesting experience interviewing all these gentlemen. And there were more than you see on the photo. Well, when I was interviewing them for this independent oral history project I was conducting, I realized that most of these men were married to French women, but these women rarely intervened and mostly remained silent while their husbands told me their war stories. When that project was completed, I said to myself, I should tell the women's stories as well. So in 1996, I began interviewing French war brides of World War II, beginning with the mother of a French-American friend of mine who lived, she just passed away last year in Kentucky. I also started doing archival research, both in France and the US, as well as background reading on the war bride phenomenon in general. And while I was doing this, I discovered that there were just as many French war brides after World War I as after World War II. And that many of the procedures set in place by the US Army and other organizations began back in 1917, 1918, and 1919. Just a little footnote before I proceed any further. There are also two personal reasons for my interest in war brides, which I mention in the prologue to my book. One concerns how my parents met. Although they were both Americans, Their love story was typical of many that blossomed during the unsettling and dramatic times of World War II. My mother, a young woman from Wisconsin, was a secretary in San Francisco when she met my father, who was a naval officer on leave from the war in the Pacific, at the rooftop cocktail bar of the Mark Hopkins Hotel. Love at first sight, a sense of urgency, a need to connect and establish roots during those bleak, uncertain times. Whatever. My parents met, fell in love, and married, all within a time span of only 2 weeks. My father returned to the war and my mother became an American war bride at the age of 19. The second anecdote happened in Paris, where we moved as a family in the winter of 1962 for my father's job. It was then that I discovered that the father of the 17-year-old son of our concierge was a GI whom she'd met at a street dance on May 8, 1945. After their brief affair, he was sent back to the States and to his wife, and poor Marcel was left with a souvenir baby, as they were called back then. By the way, she never remarried, never heard from her GI lover again, and brought up her son alone. As I said, I did archival research and background reading about the war bride phenomenon after both world wars. But most of the interviews I did from 1996 to 2003 were with French war brides of World War II. Nevertheless, I was able to collect the stories of three French war brides of World War I as told in their letters, their diaries, and as recounted to me by their daughters. Right here in this slide, you see the three different versions of my war bride's book. The first one I wrote in French because my interviews were in French, and it was published by a French publishing house called Talendier. And I'd like you just to notice the cover. The cover was taken, I think the publishing house found it from a movie, and they put the emphasis on the GIs and not on the brides. So literally speaking, it says the loves of the GIs, the little fiancés of D-Day, all right? Now, the middle one was, I later translated my book into English. I did it myself, and it was published by an American publishing house called Prager, and it came out in 2007, so 3 years later. And here the emphasis is on war brides, and they chose for their cover a photo of the wedding of one of the women that I interviewed. So it's called French War Brides in America, an Oral History. And the third cover is from a 2017 edition, because Prager didn't want to bring out my book in a paperback nor as an ebook. And with a friend of mine who has a small publishing firm, we decided to bring it out as both an ebook and a paperback. And here again, I've put the emphasis, I wanted to make it very adaptable to both World War I and World War II. So I called it French War Brides, Mademoiselle and the American Soldier. Whereas the other two editions, it was much more emphasis on World War II. All right, but before we begin the talk, my talk about the women, I'd like to get the context of their encounters with doughboys, who, by the way, were usually called Sammies, read Uncle Sam, by the French. So it was not until the summer of 1918, almost at the end of the war, that about 2 million American expeditionary forces under General Pershing arrived massively in France. Before that, there were, of course, American aviators, volunteer aviators, and ambulance drivers, such as Ernest Hemingway. The American soldiers debarked and re-embarked after the war was over at ports on the Atlantic coast on the western side of France. So please have a look at the map. You'll see they disembarked at Brest, which is in Brittany, near Nantes at the port of Saint-Nazaire, which isn't on the map, but you can see Nantes, and at Bordeaux, which was on the Dordogne River inlet. All told, Americans' losses were between 70,000 and 100,000 men. During the war, while the French soldiers, who were called poilu means hairy because of their beards and mustaches, were fighting on the front, French women worked in factories, on farms, and took care of the children. And sometimes, as you can see in this photo here, wives or fiancés would even travel to towns close to the front to be near their husbands and fiancés, as this slide shows. And what it says is, I recount in L'Oeuvre, which is, I found this at the Library of Congress, it was a French book that was written. I recount how I came to the front to get married. And you see a poilu with his wife. All right, well, this phenomenon scared the US Army and US government, because they were afraid that French women, and there were quite a few widows at that time, as I'd said, there were 2 million deaths among French soldiers. And so what happened was that for every French woman of marriageable age, there were four to one eligible Frenchman after the war. And the fear was that American soldiers who came to France towards the end of the war and were not fatigued the way the French were, had fewer deaths, etc. They were tall, they were attractive. They became a good catch for a French woman, so to speak. And even before the expeditionary force set foot in France, the US Army and General Pershing feared the spread of venereal disease among the troops. And they were very, very cautious about American soldiers frequenting French prostitutes. And there were all sorts of ordinances that came out warning the doughboys of the dangers. For example, the general order of July 2nd, 1917 appealed to the soldiers' sense of patriotism. One line said, "A soldier who contracts a venereal disease not only suffers permanent injury, but renders himself inefficient as a soldier and becomes an encumbrance to the army." The underlying message was, you should remain abstinent while you're over there. Another order in December of 1917, told them that all brothels at ports of debarkation were off limits. When it was later reported to French Premier Georges Clemenceau that the doughboys were accosting French women in the streets, he wrote to General Pershing in February of 1918 saying, "I think a solution would be to have licensed, medically inspected houses of prostitution for American soldiers, the way we do for our men." Apparently, General Pershing considered the proposal, but when the Secretary of State, Newton Baker, saw the letter, he exclaimed, "For God's sake, don't show this to the president or he'll stop the war." Consequently, the American Army and the government never went along with Clemenceau's suggestion to have medically inspected houses of prostitution. In fact, the US Army and the government were very afraid of any French women, even respectable ones, latching on to doughboys during their R&R, because the government feared the soldiers would then not want to return to the front, or that the woman would be in a town near the front and would distract the soldiers from fighting. And if some of these women actually married an American soldier, they would be entitled to an allotment from the soldier's pay. And the American Army would be obliged to pay for their transportation to the US after the war. Likewise, if the soldier was killed in battle, a French wife would be entitled to war risk insurance benefits as the beneficiary. So the Army and the American government tried very hard to discourage any sort of fraternization between French women and the doughboys. According to Mark Meggs, who's the author of Optimism at Armageddon, Voices of American Participants in the First World War, and a professor at the University of Paris, their solution was to keep the boys busy so that they wouldn't mix at all with French women. Meggs discusses this in two chapters of his book, one entitled Americans' Encounters with French Culture, and the other, Sexual Attitudes of the Doughboys. Meggs suggests that in order to keep the boys busy, the American government got the YMCA and the American Red Cross involved. And they sent over employees and volunteers, both during the war and after it was over. We need to remember that there was a problem after both world wars of getting all the soldiers back to the United States. There simply weren't enough ships to do it right away. So the YMCA, the American Red Cross, and the Army set up all sorts of activities for the doughboys to keep them out of trouble while they were waiting to get back to America. And these activities, as you can see on the slide, included tourism all over France, as well as various leave areas with recreational and sports facilities. One of these leave areas was Aix-les-Bains in the French Alps. Anywhere from 48,000 to 113,000 American soldiers came to Aix, the first figure being the wise figures, and the second, the towns. Doughboys were encouraged to take French lessons in towns and cities where they were waiting. And after the armistice, the AEF set up the AEF University at Beaune in Burgundy in the former buildings of an American hospital. The university operated from February to June of 1919. And in those 4 months, some 9,500 American soldiers attended classes while they waited to get home. Through my research, I discovered that the two American churches in Paris, the American Church and the American Cathedral — American Church is the church on the left, the American Cathedral, the one on the right in the slide, to keep the boys busy and away from loose French women during and after the war. So you've got the American Cathedral on the right, under Dean Beekman, opened an American Soldiers and Sailors Club on October 19th, 1917, as early as 1917. The club contained a reception room, a reading and writing room, a library, a billiard room, a canteen restaurant, and various offices. Every Wednesday and Saturday night for 15 months, entertainments with French singers, musicians, and dancers were given. For many months, free ice cream, cigarettes, and books were distributed daily to wounded American soldiers in Paris hospitals. For convalescents, it offered sightseeing tours in Paris and to nearby sites like Versailles. As for the interdenominational Protestant American Church, it was also involved in entertaining American soldiers. And Dr. Goodrich, the pastor, and Mrs. Goodrich helped in introducing Mother's Day into France. A special service took place on the second Sunday of May 1918. And after the service, Mrs. Goodrich and her ladies committee hosted gatherings both at the American Church and at all the soldier centers throughout Paris. Dr. Goodrich, with the help of the American consul's wife, had also convinced the French Catholic Archbishop to offer special Mother's Day services at French Catholic churches throughout France, where American soldiers might be present that day. One result of this first Mother's Day in France was a flood of letters from doughboys who poured into American homes. Apparently, in every church or center where servicemen gathered that day, this inquiry in some form was made to them. When did you write your mother last? Indeed, throughout the war and afterwards, the Army, the YMCA, and the American Red Cross conducted a wide-scale campaign to encourage soldiers, doughboys to remember their mothers. This is revealed in issues of the Stars and Stripes of 1918 and 1919. In one such issue, entitled Coming Home, soldiers could see a doughboy hugging his mom with a caption, "Back to home and mother." The underlying connotation undoubtedly being, don't do anything she'd be ashamed of while you're over there. The other theme that would sometimes be stressed in the Stars and Stripes reminded the doughboys to think about the girl they left behind, who is often equated with America and liberty. As you can see, the caption on this photo, the torch in liberty's hand is the girl you left behind, implying that the doughboys were fighting for her, but also for liberty. Nevertheless, as military historians have pointed out, combat and sexual activity usually go hand in hand. So despite the US Army's campaign, the doughboys did mix with local French women. Brothels were off limits, but many soldiers boldly picked up French women on the streets, often offering them money, and even respectable women would sometimes succumb. Why? A French historian of prostitution writes, during the war, separation of couples, the huge number of French widows who found themselves forced to support families alone, and the large concentrations of men away from both the restraining force and emotional ties of family and society led to increased sexual activity. Preoccupation with sex and women often came out in the songs doughboys sang as well during the war. The most popular AEF song, Mademoiselle Femme Entière, parlez-vous, Mademoiselle Femme Entière, parlez-vous, which actually was written by a British sergeant, portrays most British and American soldiers' crude regard for French women. Not only was it full of sexual innuendos, such as that hinky dinky parlez-vous of the refrain, but also it insulted French women, stressing their looseness and unfaithfulness as revealed in the verse, such as this one, but there were many, many others and many, many different versions, often, most often vulgar. My froggy girl was true to me. She was true to me. She was true to you. She was true to the whole damn army too. Another song, How You Gonna Keep Them Down on the Farm After They've Seen Paris, evoked the fears American farmers and their wives had about their sons being over in France in such lines as, how you gonna keep them away from harm? That's a mystery. They'll never wanna see a rake or plow, and who the deuce can parlez-vous, a cow? How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? Or another one, though you may think it's strange, but wine and women play the mischief with a boy who's loose with change. Remember that French women were poverty stricken just after the war, and Americans had their salary and were buying in local shops and that type of thing. Nevertheless, despite such a sexually charged atmosphere, serious relationships did develop between doughboys and French women. And as you can see in the picture, the doughboy would often have a little French-English dictionary along with him when he talked to French women. There were 6,000 to 6,500, we're not exactly sure, Franco-American marriages that were later registered in town halls across France. You should know that in France, even today, you must get married in a town hall in front of a mayor, and this is the only marriage that is recognized. Of course, you can then have a religious wedding, such as this one, if you so desire, but it's the civil wedding at the town hall that counts. And just a little aside, when I married a Frenchman back in the 1970s, we first got married in the town hall of the 6th arrondissement in Paris. And then later that day, we had a religious ceremony at the American Cathedral in Paris. In his book, Optimism and Armageddon, Mark Meggs describes a typical wedding. The weddings needed witnesses. Between half and two-thirds of the marriages took place with a mix of French and Americans present. Usually, the American soldier would bring a friend. Mechanics tended to be supported by other mechanics, cooks by cooks, military police by their friends in that service. The French woman would have some family members, a mother, a father, an aunt, an uncle, sign the official marriage register. In more than a third of the marriages, the American soldier found himself all alone, surrounded by the family of his bride. Sometimes a witness would be a clerk from the town hall, or even a waiter recruited for the purpose from a nearby cafe. Meigs, who studied the town hall marriage registers of the French municipalities of Beaune, Brest, Dijon, and Aix-les-Bains, which were all near American camps, hospitals, and leave areas, draws an interesting conclusion from the data he obtained. In the usual pattern set in French marriage registers, a working class girl with one or both parents dead, more frequently the father than the mother, married a working class man, currently an enlisted man in the AEF, also with one or both parents dead, more frequently the mother than the father. He goes on to state that a possible conclusion to be drawn from the remarkable number of motherless American soldiers who married French women is that the lack of a mother, the symbol so frequently employed by the army to encourage loyalty to home and country, freed men to marry outside their own culture. In her article, Forgotten Women, War Brides of World War I, Nina Jakovich, I'm not sure of the pronunciation of her name, who consulted documents at the US National Archives, states, the average French war bride was in her early 20s and of rural background. The American soldier whom she married was frequently Catholic and from the West or Midwest. However, a French scholar, Yves-Henri Noyat, who studied the marriage registers of Saint-Nazaire, Nantes, and the surrounding villages, drew another conclusion. He divided the women who married Americans into two groups according to their profession. He surmised that those women who listed their professions as maid, waitress, typist, laundress, etc., could have been women that Americans met during the course of their daily lives while they were in France. While the women who didn't work often signaled that American was being lodged in the home of a French family where they got to know the daughter of the family. And you'll see one of my war brides, that's exactly what happened. The author of the article, Forgotten Women, states that the US Army was unprepared for these marriages and failed to provide overseas commanders with an official policy or standardized procedure. AEF officials regarded the marriages between American soldiers and French civilians as prejudicial to military interest. On the whole, though, they considered marriage a personal right and a privilege of the individual soldier. This is why American military authorities declined either to give express consent to marriages or to prohibit them. Nevertheless, getting married wasn't easy. A soldier would usually have to get his commanding officer's approval, and a lot of officers wouldn't give this approval, or they'd restrict the soldier's leaves. And camp chaplains and army newspapers campaigned overtly against marrying French women, often at the expense of the reputation of Mademoiselle. And for African-American soldiers, Mademoiselle didn't even have a place in their lives. Meigs quotes an African-American YMCA worker who complained that white America had exported its prejudices to France. He said that stories of the roughness of colored men, that was the term that he used, were being told to civilians so that all possible association between them might be avoided and that they were unworthy of any courtesies from French homes. It would have been difficult then for a Black soldier to approach a French woman. Meigs goes on to state that in the town register of Chambéry, where Black soldiers took their leaves, not a single American, African-American soldier married a French woman during the war years. So in the absence of American regulations, marriages between soldiers and civilians remained subject to French civil law. However, this caused much confusion because once the couple was married, the bride lost her French citizenship. The soldiers and their wives and relatives were concerned about the women's citizenship status and turned to American military and government officials for advice and assistance. Faced with a growing number of inquiries concerning wartime weddings, the American government reluctantly assumed responsibility for the welfare of the war brides and their transportation to the United States. So upon marriage to an American, French war brides lost their French citizenship because they became American. And American officials were obliged to issue emergency passports and travel certificates to French women who could prove that their marriages were bona fide and that their husbands had knowledge of and consented to their journey to the United States. The travel certificate entitled the French bride to overseas transportation on an army vessel. Prior to their departure from France, the war brides were assembled in the ports of Brest, Bordeaux, and Saint-Nazaire. And you can see in this picture an assembly of French war brides in Bordeaux, where they were the guests of the American Red Cross. Just as after World War II, up in Le Havre, which is in Normandy, the American Army, in cooperation with the Red Cross and the YWCA, erected hostess houses or bridal camps to provide accommodation and meals for the French women until they received notice to board an army transport vessel. In addition to helping the brides with their paperwork for entering America, YWCA and American Red Cross employees and volunteers would give the brides elementary English lessons and some cultural training and tips about what to expect in the US. And this is what also later happened at the bridal camps after World War II near Le Havre. The brides paid $1 a day for transportation to the embarkation point from wherever they lived, for room and board in the bridal camps, for their sea voyage, and for railway fare within the United States upon arrival. The women usually disembarked in New York City or Newport News, Virginia, where they were met by employees of the American Red Cross and the YWCA, who again gave them some cultural training and who helped them with their travel plans. From what I've read, the vast majority of the wives traveled to the Middle West and the West. Upon their arrival in the United States, the French war brides were usually greeted by their husbands or American relatives. Some husbands, however, were unable to meet their French wives because they were still in the army. And some men were reluctant to claim their brides because they had no means of supporting them. And while others were already married or not naturalized citizens. I haven't been able to discover whether brides whose husbands never showed up were eventually sent back to France at the expense of the American government. And if so, how many cases were entailed? However, I imagine that's what happened because it did happen later to certain World War II French war brides if their husbands never showed up. After they were reunited with their husbands and had settled in their new homes, the French women often went to local branches of the YWCA to ask for assistance or to take English lessons. They also sometimes created local French war brides associations, which they called the French Ladies Group, the Benevolent Society, and such other names. In the archives of the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs on the Quai d'Orsay in Paris, I found some interesting correspondence from the French consuls in various cities mentioning that there were French women's groups in New York, Chicago, Detroit, New Orleans, Houston, San Francisco, and Los Angeles. These war brides groups from World War I were important because the French women who belonged to them would take the French wives of World War II under their wing and act as big sisters later on. In rural parts of America, however, there were no such groups, and the French wives were on their own. It must be said, too, that as some French scholars have pointed out, unlike Americans and Brits, on the whole, French immigrants back then tended not to come together as a group or be joiners of French clubs and associations. An article in the New York Times on September 2nd, 1919 stated that 62 French brides had returned to their homes in France after obtaining divorces from their husbands because they couldn't adapt to the American way of life. 2 years later, another article from the New York Times dated December 4th, 1921 had a headline that read, "French war brides happy in America." In the article, you can read, "French a few are homesick and want to go back to Europe, but they are the exceptions." The article goes on to describe an incident in which three French war brides tearfully begged French Marechal Foch, who was on tour in Idaho, for his help in getting back to France. However, in the same article, Miss Kyler of the YWCA says, "Records show the majority of French war brides displayed the utmost fortitude in adapting themselves to American ways." As I said earlier, there are only three oral histories of French war brides in my book. And surprisingly, they all settled with their husbands on the East Coast and not in the Midwest or the West where most of the war brides went. Let's begin with Madeleine. Well, here you've got a photo, and I'm going to read from my book. She met her husband, Ken, in Royat, which is a small town near Clermont-Ferrand in the Auvergne region of France. Here's what she wrote in her diary about how she met her husband. "The whole city of Clermont-Ferrand and the near towns like Royat were occupied by the American troops. On the 19th of March, 1919, on St. Joseph's feast day, I had to go to the ground floor to pay the coal man. The landlady started to talk to me about two American soldiers who wanted something, but she didn't speak English and she had no idea what they wanted. They were presented to me. They already had taken possession of a room on the first floor that they rented. The landlady thought I might be able to find out what they wanted. Ken and his friend Joe, with great pain, finally made me understand that they were looking for a place to take their meals regularly, preferably in a family. My knowledge of English was almost nil, especially in conversation. They tried to give me some references by showing me their rosaries. Somehow, I felt an assurance that they were good, honest, sincere people. Then, after laborious explanations, I was able to tell my mother what it was all about, and she accepted to have them take their meals with us. Of course, St. Joseph was with us that day. In the meantime, they went to the University of Clermont-Ferrand to learn French in a hurry. We were not very cooks, but we had good moments. Playing the piano, singing, reading, taking hikes in the mountains, visiting interesting places. And I was always accompanied by a family member. While Ken and his friend Joe were with us, he didn't seem to pay particular attention to me. However, he later asked if I needed references about his character. And so we wrote to his parish in Philadelphia, and we received an excellent report. Like Madeleine, he was Catholic, okay? And one saintly priest in Clermont-Ferrand knew him well too. He told us that Ken was by far the best of the American soldiers he had ever met. He even thought he might have had a vocation to be a priest. Ken and his friends stayed with us for meals for about 3 months. Then they were sent somewhere else and later went back to the United States. Ken and I promised each other we would write, and we did. He was to come back the next year in June of 1920 for our wedding in Royat. Ken was 26 years old, and I was almost 22. Ken's mother came to our wedding, which was celebrated in the Church of the Sacred Heart, close to our apartment. The couple settled in Philadelphia and lived with Ken's parents in a row house in the southwestern part of town. Apparently, Madeline's mother-in-law wasn't very nice to her, and we'll talk about this phenomenon later on. The couple went on to buy their own house and had 9 children. Madeline also spoke French with the children. Sorry, she only spoke French with the children and forbade them to speak English at home because she wanted them to be bilingual. And she thought that they would learn English in school. She became a French teacher at the Alliance Française and in private schools. Her family came to visit over the years, but she was only able to return once to France in 1946 for a visit. Marie-Jeanne, who is the next French war bride in my book, she was born in a small village in southern France near the Italian border and met her husband in Nice at a formal reception that was being given for American soldiers and respectable young French women. A US Army Corps pilot from Ohio, he had a flying accident in Italy and was convalescing in France. Here's how Marie-Jeanne's daughter summarized the courtship of her parents. Now I'm reading from my book. All right. The day after a reception, because they met at this reception, an armful of roses, Daddy, she said, sorry, Daddy arrived at my grandparents' home with an armful of roses. My grandmother opened the door, and there was a young man with a huge bunch of flowers. This sort of thing was not done at the time, but he was allowed to come in. I don't know what happened afterwards. My father returned to Italy and started writing to Maman, but my grandfather always read the letters before giving them to his daughter. And then after a while, my grandmother took pity on my mother. She'd watch for the postman, intercept the letters, and give them to Maman. And the love story continued like that. I don't know exactly how long all that continued, however, probably about a year. In the end, he asked her to marry him. I think, but I'm not sure, that he was able to come to Nice several times. But my parents were never alone until the day of their marriage. As a matter of fact, my mother was meant to marry the son of a family friend who was going to become an ambassador. My grandfather had announced that his daughter would never marry an American soldier. But my mother insisted that her dear American soldier was the one she wanted. So then all my family went about trying to convince my grandfather. But before considering anything, my grandfather required letters of reference from my father's family in Ohio and from his church. You see, Daddy came from a very devout Protestant family of Methodists. Everything went ahead, and after the wedding took place on August 4th, 1919 in Nice, Mama was 21 years old and Daddy was 5 years older. I have a wonderful photo where you see a very distinguished French family, the whole wedding party. Daddy is in uniform and the other men are wearing top hats and tails. In September, my parents left by ship with many other couples for New York. Other soldiers were on board with their French wives. So like Madeleine, Marie-Jeanne also became a French teacher in a private school. Later on, she was appointed directress of the French house at Oberlin College. During the summer, she was a guide for varsity tours in Boston and took groups to France. And this enabled her to see her family and to leave her daughter with them so that she'd learn French. As for the third war bride in my book, Paulette, she was born in Rochefort-sur-Mer on the Atlantic coast, but she grew up in Paris. During the summer of 1918, when she was 18, she went with her mother and her sisters to spend a few days at a friend's hotel in Wayon, which is near Rochefort. While strolling down the boardwalk in their lovely white dresses and large sun hats, they met Robert, an American sailor. Here's what Paulette's daughter told me. So I'm just going to read a passage. My father was born in the United States in 1897 of parents who had very recently immigrated from Scotland. During the Great War, he served in the American Navy as radio signalman on a ship, assuring the protection of convoys landing in the Gironde region of France. On July 9th, 1918, when he was on leave, he met a young girl who was born in Rochefort in 1900. She and her mother, who was the widow of a colonial administrator in Senegal, her sister and her brother, were all spending a holiday in Wayon at the Hotel Richelieu. Probably to start a conversation, he asked, in English, of course, a language which was unfamiliar to her, just as much as French was unfamiliar to him, for some information, which, although rather puzzled, she tried to give him once they arrived at the hotel. He wanted to know about escrima. At least that's what she thought he was asking. In fact, after some discussion, they finally discovered that it was simply a question of trying to find some ice cream. You see, the word escrime in French means fencing. So she thought he was asking about fencing when in fact he was asking about ice cream. So they later married and moved to Michigan in January of 1919. But after she got pregnant, Paulette wanted to return to France to be near her mother and her sister and to bring up her child there. So Robert got a job with an American company in Paris and they moved back to Paris, to France. The marriage wasn't a happy one because Robert became an alcoholic and later lost his job. He returned alone to America in 1935, and Paulette only saw him once again in 1958. Meanwhile, she had gotten a job as a writer for a French fashion magazine, L'Officiel de la Culture, writing articles about silk and corset. And I guess that's a link with the museum's exhibit on silk and steel. She never remarried. And during World War II, she and her daughter hid Allied soldiers who'd been shot down over France and helped get them back to England. For their efforts after the war was over, they both received the prestigious French military medal, La Croix de Guerre. Now, I realize that these were just three stories, and these three women were rather privileged in certain respects. They didn't live in rural parts of America, and all three said they had contact with other French war brides where they were living. Of the three, only one didn't adapt to life in America and she returned to France. But I'm sure they all had difficulties, which came up again and again when I interviewed French war brides of World War II. What were some of the issues the brides faced? First off, there was the reputation and stereotypes of French women as ooh-la-la girls. And this can date back to 1848 and the gold rush, because there were saloons and dance hall girls and prostitutes in the American West. And another song that had a big effect on Americans' vision of French women were songs like Mademoiselle d'Armentier, parlez-vous, Mademoiselle d'Armentier, parlez-vous, okay? Stories about Paris, about Pigalle and all the nightclubs there. Another theme that occurred uh, that affected and that affected these French American marriages, both after World War I and World War II, was the theme of transition and change. I mean, it was very difficult for these women to adapt to a new culture. Often they didn't speak the language. Material problems such as housing, living with the in-laws, maybe not being able to get a job if they later divorced, that type of thing. Another problem that frequently came up in my interviews were the mother-in-law, what I call the mother-in-law syndrome, because the American mothers-in-law often didn't accept their French daughters-in-law. Many of these women themselves were of immigrant stock, and their desire for their sons was to marry a typical American girl and not a French immigrant, as they said. There were lots of marriage issues, that incomprehension, not lack of empathy for the other. There was the husband's drinking oftentimes, and then the husband who didn't understand the French war bride or the French culture. There were communication problems. I mean, it was always up to the, on I would say 98% of the time, it was up to the French women to learn English and not vice versa. And the women often have very strong French accents, and this could cause problems for them. There were cultural issues between the differences between French and American cultures. The French women came from families where the value of the family was often stressed, and there were multi-generational families with the grandparents and aunts and uncles living with a nuclear family, whereas in America it was often the nuclear family. Different ways of parenting, of taking care of the house, the importance for the French of French girls of meals and food. And I don't know if you ever saw the film, what was it? I've forgotten. Anyway, it's an Italian war bride who came to live in Kansas. It'll come back to me, the title. Anyway, she for her, it was very important to have sit down meals and to discuss, etc. Whereas the American farmer husband, and often the children, didn't have patience to sit down. The bridges of Madison County. Yes, right. Thank you for one of the one of the people listening. That is great. I couldn't remember the title. The importance of, as I said, of food and meals, different ways of parenting. The French family was probably stricter than the American family, which was more a nuclear family, as I said, than you didn't have the grandparents, etc. The importance of French history, that the French are very proud of their history, their culture, their language. And oftentimes if they married somebody who lived in the Middle West, the husband didn't have a clue of this at all. And maybe had stopped school at an early age, and certainly didn't know how to speak French. The France is a much smaller country, more homogeneous, I would think, especially at that time, against the vastness and the of space in the United States. And so it's both a smaller country. France is a more homogeneous country, especially back at that time, smaller than the vastness of the United States, and the heterogeneous culture that, well, although there were many, it was an immigrant culture, but it was the great emphasis on becoming American, and the vastness of physical space in the United States as well, where France is much, much smaller. And through my research of of the brides after World War I and World War II and the marriages that ensued. One theme that came out quite a lot was this American dream. So many of these young women suffered loss during World War I and during World War II, later during World War II, and the American dream represented hope for them for starting a new life. Many of them, of the war brides that I've, after both world wars, were rather, how can I say, they were very optimistic about starting a new life, even a little bit naive that of the difficulties that were involved. They were young, I would say between 18 and 22, something like that. And they weren't really ready for marriage. Most of them came from very strict Catholic families. Another theme that emerged was the alcoholism of the husband, which he learned when he was in France during both world wars. They would often go to nightclubs and to bars, et cetera, and or just drink on their own. It was for these women, both after World War I and World War II, they had to adapt. It was up to them to adapt to the new culture. They were homesick. They had culture shock. One big idea was, should we keep up our French language or should we not? You know, should we just bring up our children to be Americans, or should we keep the French culture in the family? But I discovered that despite all this, that most of these women were very courageous. They got on with it, and they had to, though it was very, very expensive to go back to Europe, and they didn't go back to Europe. Later on after World War II, because I do talk mostly about World War II in my book, it became easier, but you can imagine after World War I that it would be very, very difficult to go back to France to visit their families. What did they like about the US? Well, they liked the friendliness of Americans. They liked the material comfort of the homes. They liked the possibilities that they had to continue their educations or even work. What did they miss? Well, they missed, you can imagine, they missed the food. They liked the croissant and the cafes. They liked the bread, French bread. They missed the French bread. They loved that. They missed their families, of course. They were homesick. They missed, is interesting enough, they missed the old stones of French buildings, of chateaus, of churches. Well, just to conclude about that is that I found these women were very courageous, and I admired them. They didn't all live happily once they got to America. Some of the husbands, as I said, have problems with alcohol. They were sometimes out in the middle of the countryside with no contact with other French people. They were homesick, but they got on with it, even if things didn't work out. So in conclusion, I'd just like to say, finally, we can say that the end of a world war, which was more often than not a time of intense romanticism and urgency, these war brides courageously left their country and their families to start a new life in a new land. They had to confront the difficulties engendered by bicultural marriage, expatriation, and assimilation into the new culture. Many of the women encountered personal and economic difficulties along the way. A few, but it would seem not many, of the women returned to France. And despite it all, most of the women carried on despite the difficulties and made constructions of their new lives. There is thus a very poignant and universal quality about their experience, which goes far beyond their encounters and marriages with American soldiers. Merci. Thank you. Thank you for listening. And I'd love to answer any of your questions if you have some.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kaiser. We're going to go ahead and take a few questions from the Q&A section. We have a question from Chris Dubs. How many of these couples ended up living in France as opposed to returning to the United States?
I don't have any documentation. It's very difficult to keep statistics about this, to even find statistics. Most of them stayed in the States. However, after the Second World War, there were some of the husbands' jobs, because of course France became much more international after World War II, you know, and has continued to be so. So the husbands would find jobs in France with American companies or the embassy, or et cetera, and bring his wife and family back to France. So that, but I can't tell you exact numbers, sorry.
So we have a question from Annette. How long did it take to bring the French war brides to the United States because of the shortage of ships after the war? Were the soldiers repatriated first and the war brides came later?
There was both. There were, from what I've read, sometimes the soldiers were, you know, came first and then the wives followed. Because there were not enough, as I said, there were not enough ships to bring everybody back at the same time. So priority was given to the men, and then the women came later. But as I said too, that, you know, the army and the YMCA and the Red Cross, etc., were trying to keep these soldiers busy while they were waiting to get back to the States. And then sometimes the couples would come back together. The government would pay for, the army would pay for the couples to come over to the States later on, but mostly in 1919, you know, which was quite a, you know, at least six months after the end of the war.
Paul asks, do the locations of the French Wives Associations in the United States suggest that soldiers from certain regions were more likely to marry French women, such as American soldiers from Louisiana, given the state's historic French culture?
That I can't answer. I haven't done any research on that. I think they came from mostly all over the place, though. I mean, they didn't just come from, you know, Louisiana. No, they really came from all over the United States. Mm-hmm.
Joan asks, were there striking similarities or differences between the French war brides of World War I and World War II?
Well, I think, you know, World War II, it was later on, and I think the war brides were more aware of a better life that would exist in America than what they would have if they stayed in wartime, post-wartime France. So I think on the whole, the similarities were things that I mentioned at the end of my talk about, you know, about what they liked about America. The differences would be maybe, I think the French war brides of World War II would be a little bit more cosmopolitan than the war brides of World War I, who were not really used to, you know, an international, you know, and most of them, I would imagine, came from farms, and you know, I haven't got all the access on the figures of that, but probably a little bit easier for the French war brides of World War II, of course, you know, and there was this aura of the American soldier, which existed after both wars. And also, I think theme that really came out was a better life, rather than staying in war-torn Europe, you know, to begin again in America, no matter where, you know, it still was a better life than what they would have staying in France right after both wars.
Have you found evidence of French war brides befriending war brides from other countries living in the United States?
Yes, I have. Yeah, especially maybe European, not so much the Asian war brides, but the Europeans, you know, between the French and the Italians and the Belgians and the Even Germans, I mean, the German war brides, you know, after World War II, were, and, you know, there were German war brides as well after World War I. So, but I think the European culture tended to, there was a tendency that European women of European origin would mix fairly well. And there seemed to be, I mean, I know that after World War II, I know less about World War I, but after World War II, there are still, even today, very active British war brides associations. I discovered that, you know, that the French tend to congregate around the Alliance Française or various groups like that, where the British, there was still, when I started my research back in the, you know, in the late 90s and beginning of 2000, there were still very, very active British war brides groups, where the French tended to go towards the Alliance Française, you know, which is a cultural place. I don't think there are any, at the moment, any French war brides associations in America. I don't think so, except through the Alliance Française or that type of thing, yeah. Mm.
Deborah asks, do you think the British war brides adapted to life in the States more easily because there weren't the same language problems, or were there cultural differences that also caused a few issues?
Well, from what I've read, I mean, I don't know so much about the British after World War I. I know more about the British after World War II. They, you know, the Americans landed, were in Britain preparing the landings and had they had language in common with the Brits, with the British war brides. I know there are British war brides associations that are very active still. Can you just repeat the question again? I can't remember what it was.
Oh, did British war brides, one moment, it has disappeared on me.
I don't see it either.
Did British adapt to life in the States more easily than the French war brides?
Oh, I would definitely think so. They have the language in common. I mean, definitely. And then the British war brides, I did get in touch with us when I was doing my research in California. I did get in touch with some local war brides associations, which were supposed to be international, but they were was for the Europeans, if you like, but it was mostly dominated by women who had married, English women who had married American soldiers, and the numbers are something three times more, because, you know, they didn't have the problem of language, they had a common sort of English language culture that the French had a hard time, and other groups as well. I mean, even later, you know, with World War II, with the Asian Americans, they had a terrible time. No, it was difficult for the French. It was a completely different society, and the language problem came up over and over. They said, "Oh, I'm so tired of, you know, saying, oh, I like your language, I like your accent." They wanted to be more American. They didn't want to be so French, you know. And then often, as you know, what I discovered after both world wars, that, you know, there was this bad reputation of French girls being easy, of, you know, well, prostitution existed in other cultures as well, but, you know, this idea of, you know, being up in Montmartre in Paris and doing the can-can and all that, this was something that these French women had to live with, and it was difficult for them, because most of them were Catholic, and they were strict, you know. Most of their families were very strict with them, and so, but they had this reputation of the French girl, you know, which was, and of course there were French prostitutes, there were all that, and maybe some of the women, you know, took advantage of using sex to get to America. I don't know, but I didn't study that. When I was doing my research for all of these women, they were pretty, not as open as we are in America about, you know, our sexual lives and this type of thing. I really had to, you know, and I couldn't go too far into, you know, exactly what attracted them about an American or something. It was, it's, they're very, reserved, if you like, about, especially women of that generation, you know, so. Yeah, it's, but there certainly is the American dream that still exists.
Robert says that a recent memoir describes the experience of a World War II French bride as being between two chairs, either an ocean away from their French family or a voyage away from her American husband. Did you find the same thing with World War I brides?
Interesting. Well, I didn't actually, as I've said, it was because of a different generation, and I only was able to, I had one real war bride I was supposed to interview, and she died about 3 or 4 days before I was supposed to interview her, you know, because it, that was of World War I, but of World War II, World War I and World War II, I had a feeling that they were, when you say, Robert, when you say a voyage away from their American husband, do you mean that in a figurative sense, or do you mean that in, I'm wondering if he's saying that a voyage away from her American husband, because she often immigrated to the States with a husband on the same ship. So I don't know if you're talking figuratively, that she wasn't on the same wavelength as her American husband, which was obviously quite true, but that's what I was very impressed of when I was writing this book and interviewing people, even though I didn't have a first person interview with a World War I. I had the daughters or through their diaries, this type of thing. I had the feeling that they were, on the whole, They were pleased with the experience. I mean, there were divorces, and the causes of divorce are cultural differences and alcoholism and all sorts of things. But I had the feeling that at least to the World War I experience, that they were the women were making a great effort for that to work, for their marriage to work. I'm not really sure what Robert is trying to ask me, but that's what they, of course they were, and because French people through the culture are very family oriented, and of course it was very hard for them to leave their families and to go, and probably without the hope of returning, because it was beyond means for many, many people to come back, many of these women to come back to even visit their families. And as I think I read a passage where it said she'd only gone back once, whereas their family, I guess, did come over a bit, so.
Robert says he meant it literally. The women went back to France with their girls, but their husbands at some times were still working in America. Karen asks, did the French war brides seem to exhibit a sense of regret in their senior years or a sense of positivity in your interviews?
Well, as I said, I only have three World War I brides, and it's not a direct interview, you know, but from their daughters, it sounded like these three there was one that went back to France, that's right. So, but I can't make big generalizations about World War I brides, but I can more about World War II brides. Can you just remind me of the question again? Sorry.
Yeah. Did the French war brides seem to exhibit a sense of regret or a sense of positivity in their senior years?
Oh, well, I can speak more about World War II for there, but the brides that I interviewed for World War II and the indirect interviews I had for World War I, one of the themes is that, you know, their lives materially were much better off being in America. And many of them got jobs, which they probably wouldn't have been able to do in France. They had, you know, better lifestyle. of course, they missed certain things from France. They missed the, you know, the food and everything I mentioned before, the baguette. And but I think on the whole, they were happy to be in America. And they had, for especially women who were a little bit courageous and who wanted to work, they had much better opportunities to work in the US. Many of them became French teachers. I mean, that's a theme that just keeps going through everything, you know, became French teachers. I don't know if that answers the question, but.
Carol says that, and I apologize if I mispronounce the name, Mary Jean. Her dress is so elaborate, not a parachute dress that you read about British war brides wearing. Was Mary Jean's dress a family heirloom?
For her wedding? Was that? I don't remember Mary Jean. Who are we talking about now?
There we go.
Is that a quote from my book or?
It doesn't seem to be a quote. I think she was just observing the dress.
Okay, and which photo? That's it. I'll have to go back.
I believe her dress.
Okay. Her wedding dress?
Yes.
Now, what was the question exactly again? Sorry.
Was it a family heirloom?
That I cannot tell you. I'm sorry. I would imagine so. But isn't that a wonderful picture, though, with the husband looking at her and the father, very traditional, you know, in his uniform as well. And the top hats of the guests, yes.
Right. And we will take two last questions. Beverly asks, what similarities, if any, would you say you experienced as an American wife and mother in the French society? Is that part of your attraction to this topic?
That's a friend of mine. That's me the question. Okay. Yeah, it's, you know, it's in a romantic theme. You marry out of your culture. And I mean, you can... And of course, there are cultural differences, you know. And I mean, I married my French husband back in 1970, you know. So, and I had studied, I think what attracted me to France is I had studied French. I'd majored in French in college. I'd lived in France as a teenager when my father had a job there. And so, of course, I was very interested, and I used to teach intercultural communication. So, I mean, I'm very interested in cultural differences, and you know, I had French in-laws. I went to my children went to French schools, and I'm very, very interested in cultural differences. But I think the fact that my parents married during World War II, even though my father was in the Pacific, they met and they married very quickly, you know, and they were allowed to marry very quickly. Whereas, you know, sometimes it was very difficult, especially in World War I, very difficult to marry a foreign wife, because the army was discouraging these marriages. Even in World War II, the army was trying to discourage any sort of international relationship during the war. So.
And then lastly, James asks that as a dual national, what is something you believe Americans should understand about France and the French during World War I?
Interesting. Interesting question. Think that something that, you know, when I first started researching about World War I, I had not realized that the Americans had only been in France, were only fighting in France for 6 months. Okay, they'd only been, whereas France, by the time the Americans entered the war, they were tired. I mean, they'd lost so many men, they were tired. And I think I think as American, I mean, I have French citizenship as well through marriage, but as Americans, we tend to think, you know, that all the heroic part of going to war in France, and of course we wouldn't have, World War I would have ended completely differently, and World War II if Americans hadn't come over. But I sometimes believe that Americans tend to sometimes think they're the saviors, you know, which they were in many ways, but that maybe not realize all the hardships that the French went through in both world wars. And I mean, even sometimes a little bit of a moralistic, you know, that, you know, why are French women prostituting themselves? You know, often it was to eat, you know, it was that bad after World War I that, you know, that this did happen. And so we tend to, in America, we tend to be a little bit moralistic. And I think it's good to understand, you know, what the French went through and had gone through. Think of all the thousands and thousands of soldiers they lost. And, you know, it's just, whereas Americans were fighting overseas, it wasn't right on their own land and everything. That, you know, they didn't realize all the problems that being at war entailed. I mean, some women prostituted themselves maybe to get food for their families, you know. So I think we'd have to put ourselves into the shoes of French people during World War I as well, and World War II, you know, because they're both wars were fought in Europe, you know. So it's a different perspective sometimes of war. And although I'm very, very admirative of all the soldiers who've lost their lives and have fought for freedom, that, of course.
Right. Well, Dr. Kaiser, thank you so much for joining us for today's conversation. Your lecture was a pleasure to listen to. We were getting quite a few compliments in the chat and the Q&A section. And for those of you, thank you for your comments and your questions. If you would like to rewatch this presentation, this will be available to watch at a later time on our YouTube channel. We will also be hosting our next Mrs. Wilson Circle lecture on October 14th. We will have more details on that program in the coming weeks. So keep an eye on our website for that. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Kaiser. Have a great rest of your day. Everyone, take care and be safe.